The young ingenue, Christine Daae, has just given her debut performance at the Opera Populaire, retreating to a small chapel after the concert to light candles before her dead father's plaque. Her childhood friend Meg enters to congratulate her, but she's also curious as to who has been giving her music lessons. "I only wish I knew your secret. Who is your great tutor?" Meg asks. Her mysterious tutor is Eric, the Phantom of the Opera, a talented composer, architect, and quote-unquote disfigured musical genius who haunts the underbelly of the opera house. Because of his physical disability, Eric teaches Christine literally through the walls, remaining an unseen, ghostly presence throughout the building. But Christine doesn't know this, that there is a mysterious and brooding disabled man tutoring her behind the walls, believing the disembodied voice instead to belong to the spirit of her dead father. After paying her respects in the chapel, Christine returns to her dressing room. Not long after, Eric calls out to her and reveals himself. "See why in shadow I hide," he sings. "Look at your face in the mirror. I am there inside.
I am there inside."
Christine turns towards the mirror. The figure of a man wearing a mask stands before her in the reflection. The mask, as we later learn from Eric, is to hide his face, a face that others fear. After some more singing, Christine walks through the mirror, taking Eric's hand as he leads her down through the catacombs beneath the opera house and into a fantastical grotto where he has hidden himself away from everyone. This scene is from the 2004 musical film, The Phantom of the Opera, one of many adaptations from the novel of the same name by Gaston Leroux, and published in 1910. The core of the story, though, remains consistent. A lonely man with a facial difference searches for love. All he wants, he tells his student Christine, the object of his romantic desires, is for her to find the man behind the monster. Welcome back to Diagnosis Grad School. In this episode, I'll be talking about the education of monsters. That is, the education of disabled people. Since Aristotle, the idea of the norm has legitimated exclusion of the disabled from human society as abnormal and monstrous, even though all people who live long enough are likely at one time or another to experience disability themselves, or be closely related to someone who is disabled. That is, what has been labeled abnormal actually occurs regularly and frequently and yes, normally. I quote directly here from Cynthia Lueke Wilson and James C. Wilson and their work on disability and rhetoric. Disability was monstrous to Aristotle and was grounds for exclusion from education or society, or even the right to life.
"Let there be a law that no deformed child shall be reared."
Disabled people have long held lesser status in society, and this lesser status has resulted in what Jay Domage, a professor of rhetoric and disability studies at the University of Waterloo, refers to as forms of lower education for disabled people. Domage explains, quote, "Disability has always been constructed as the inverse or opposite of higher education. Or, let me put it differently, higher education has needed to create a series of versions of lower education to justify its work and to ground its exceptionalism. Disabled people, Domage continues, have historically been relocated to what he calls the shadow locations of the university. Quote, for most of the 20th century, people with disabilities were institutionalized in asylums, schools for the feeble-minded, and other exclusionary institutions, locations that became the dark shadows of the college or university, connected with residential schools, prisons, quarantines, and immigration stations in these shadows. These shadow locations also had steep steps and ornate gates, meant to hold the public out and to imprison people within, ensuring that the excluded couldn't mix with others within society. They were connected in a perverse way to the hope that the elite would mingle and mix with one another exclusively in colleges and universities. Further, the ethic of higher education still encourages students and teachers alike to accentuate ability, valorize perfection, and stigmatize anything that hints at intellectual or physical weakness. Outside of these shadowy institutions, disabled people have not fared much better. Quote, there is a long history of locking away people with disabilities in attics, basements, and backrooms, disability scholar Tobin Siebers writes. But disabled people find a way, educating themselves in the shadows or behind walls, fighting for accommodations or more access, more rights. When the Americans with Disabilities Act was signed in 1990, President George Bush used a wall metaphor to describe the unchecked discrimination disabled people experienced throughout the country that restricted their rights and freedoms.
And now I sign legislation which takes a sledgehammer to another wall, one which has... one which has, for too many generations, separated Americans with disabilities from the freedom they could glimpse, but not grasp.
Bush had just been talking about the Berlin Wall, which had fallen less than a year earlier, when he made this analogy. But still, he recognized that previous American legislation and attitudes presented barriers to participation in society for disabled people. The sledgehammer wasn't entirely effective, however. There are still the ruins of this former wall that continue to keep disabled people out of all sorts of spaces. Little bits of exclusionary rubble thrown across our pathways. Here is disability writer Anne Finger on the university's mindset towards disabled students.
I don't think that most universities have an attitude towards disabled people of, here's a group we want to welcome into our community. Here's people we want to have here. We want to extend a positive effort. I think most of them know there's an Americans with Disabilities Act, there's Section 504, and we have to do certain things for them. Unfortunately, that often becomes a question of how little can we get away with legally?
How little can we get away with legally? A scary question we will return to in Chapter 3. The rest of this episode will look at two other fictional disabled figures, Victor Frankenstein's creature and Victor Frankenstein himself. Mary Shelley's 1818 text, Frankenstein, or The Modern Prometheus, is many things. A gothic novel, a tragic ghost story, a cautionary tale about the obsessive pursuit of knowledge, an epistolary novel. It's also a story about going away to university. A story about education. In my edition of the novel, I was surprised to find three sections in the text's introduction. The education of Mary Shelley, the education of Victor Frankenstein, and the education of the monster. Shelley's parents, William Godwin and Mary Wollstonecraft, were distinguished and celebrated literary figures. Her mother, a feminist, is perhaps best known for writing A Vindication of the Rights of Woman in 1792, a text that advocated for women's education, arguing that the lack of access to education made women unequal to men. Wollstonecraft believed that education would liberate women from their lesser position in society. In other words, that equal education would lead to equal status. She had experience as an educator, working as a governess and also a teacher, which doubtlessly informed her pedagogical theories. In Thoughts on the Education of Daughters, published several years before Vindication in 1787, Wollstonecraft writes, "I conceive it to be the duty of every rational creature to attend to its offspring." As we'll see shortly in Shelley's novel, the abandonment of offspring sets up the story's central conflict. Shelley's father Godwin, a political radical, had made a name for himself writing Political Justice and Caleb Williams, criticizing tyrannical governments. Themes of education, justice, and political rights inevitably ran through Shelley. Shelley's mother died 11 days after giving birth to her, leaving her father Godwin to raise Shelley and her older half-sister Fanny Imlay from Wollstonecraft's previous relationship, who Godwin adopted as his own. Although Godwin felt that he was totally unfitted to educate the two girls, he undertook the task. He provided Shelley with an unconventional education, an education that one could safely call masculine, that would not have normally been afforded to women at the time. Shelley was educated at home and exposed to various intellectual figures who would visit her father, and was given a range of things to read, some of which Shelley would read on her own mother's grave. Alan Richardson, a Romanticism scholar, rightly points out that Frankenstein is concerned about the education of children and the dilemma of self-education. Victor receives a more formal higher education, for example, compared to his creature's lower self-education in the novel, the latter having much more in common with the kind of education women would have received at the time. In fact, the books the creature reads in his self-education are ones that Shelley herself frequently turned to. And here there is another connection to be made between the creature and women of that time. Women were seen as deformed men, both morally and physically. Again, thanks, Aristotle.
"We should look upon the female state as being, as it were, a deformity."
If being female was considered something of a disability, Shelley was probably aware of it. The lesser education granted to women was part of a patriarchal system that restricted women's rights and freedoms, a system her own mother had passionately criticized. Women were also still barred from the vote on the basis that they were not seen as rational creatures. Being a woman was more of a political disability, of course. Richardson suggests that the creature's self-education functions as a sort of stand-in for female education in Shelley's novel. Both women and the creature were considered to be deformed men, monstrous bodies that deviated from the male norm. Discussing the philosopher Rousseau's treatise on education, which Shelley was well acquainted with, Richardson explains, quote, "For Rousseau, women's subordinate position in society, and thus the unequal education that facilitates her subordination, is rooted in her physical difference from man, her weakness, her capacity to bear children, and in certain moral differences which characterize her as well. Her tendency to unlimited desires and to be extreme in everything, which together make her life a perpetual combat against herself, that can only be won with the aid of modesty and habitual constraint." Shelley's critique of female education was less polemic than her mother's, less radical, choosing art rather than political philosophy as the vehicle by which to advance her ideas. This isn't to say that Shelley felt any less strongly in the need to defend and promote female education. Her opinions remained intimately aligned with her mother's until her own death. For both mother and daughter, the core message and concept remain the same: to emphasize the importance of education in liberating women from their unjust and lower position in society. But Shelley's stance on female education, as compelling as it is, isn't the focus of this episode. We're here to think about the education of disabled people, to think about disabled people learning and teaching themselves from behind walls. Our titular protagonist, the young Victor Frankenstein, enjoys an idyllic childhood in Geneva. His father, Alphonse Frankenstein, devotes himself lovingly to his children's education. "No youth could have passed more happily than mine," recalls Victor. "His parents are attentive, and his friends warm and amiable. His studies are never imposed on him, but are something he willingly attends to." This idyllic period ends abruptly, however. After the sudden death of his mother, Victor makes his transition from happy child to depressed university student. Victor, age 17, journeys to the University of Ingolstadt, leaving his beloved family and childhood companions behind. There, he learns to reanimate the dead, creating life out of lifeless matter. Victor starts out small, running simple experiments on dead materials before turning his sights to an unthinkable project, to create a being similar to man, a new species that he would father. After several years of study, he succeeds in creating a living being, that is, the infamous creature.
"It was on a dreary night of November that I beheld the accomplishment of my toils. With an anxiety that almost amounted to agony, I collected the instruments of life around me, that I might infuse a spark of being into the lifeless thing that lay at my feet. It was already 1 in the morning. The rain pattered dismally against the panes, and my candle was nearly burnt out when, by the glimmer of the half-extinguished light, I saw the dull yellow eye of the creature open. It breathed hard, and a convulsive motion agitated its limbs.
But the creature isn't at all what Victor expected. Realizing that he has given life not to a man-like being, but to a monster, Victor continues,
"How can I describe my emotions at this catastrophe? Or how delineate the wretch whom with such infinite pains and care I had endeavored to form?"
Horrified at this failure, Victor retreats to his room, throwing himself on his bed in despair and falling into an uneasy sleep. He awakens to find the creature standing over him.
"I started from my sleep with horror. I beheld the wretch, the miserable monster whom I had created. He held up the curtain of the bed, and his eyes, if eyes they may be called, were fixed on me. His jaws opened, and he muttered some inarticulate sounds while a grin wrinkled his cheeks. He might have spoken, but I did not hear. One hand was stretched out, seemingly to detain me, but I escaped and rushed downstairs. Oh, no mortal could support the horror of that countenance. A mummy, again endued with animation, could not be so hideous as that wretch. I had gazed on him while unfinished. He was ugly then, but when those muscles and joints were rendered capable of motion, it became a thing such as even Dante could not have conceived."
Victor flees his apartment, spending the night pacing manically around his apartment's courtyard, afraid of once again meeting his creation. When he returns the next morning, his creature is gone. And here Victor does something terrible, cruel even, in my opinion. He rejoices.
Sing,
Victor's decision to reject his creature is predicated, I would argue, on his physical appearance. That is, upon seeing his disabled child for the first time, the quote-unquote miserable deformity, Victor is unable to imagine a future for him, or, put another way, a future that isn't anything but monstrous.
Let there be a law that no deformed child shall be reared.
Few scholars have read the creature as disabled. Standing 8 feet tall, his body cobbled together from animal parts and human remains scavenged from a charnel house, I remain puzzled as to why. Amber Knight suggests that the creature is continuously misrecognized as a monster because of his visibly disabled body. Although the creature feels that he is an innately good and sociable being, his body is coded with negative values and repeatedly labeled as a monster, a wretch, and a fiend. Because of this misrecognition, the creature experiences unfathomable amounts of shame, social isolation, and psychological distress throughout the novel. Martha Stoddard Holmes produces a similar interpretation to my own, that of a parent responding to the birth of their disabled child, adding in an interesting secondary reading of the creature as a failed medical patient to Victor acting as doctor. Other scholars have read Victor as a bad, neglectful parent who shirks his parental duties towards the creature. I agree that Victor is a bad dad. Victor fails to teach his child, well, anything. In my reading, I would also argue that Victor refuses his child the right to education on the basis of his disability. There is also, of course, the connection that the creature is born and subsequently rejected in Victor's shadowy university apartment tower, a prescient mirror to the rejection disabled people still experience in the university today. Scholars reading Shelley's work autobiographically have pointed out that her own difficult experiences with parenthood may have informed the many themes of birth, children, and failed child-rearing throughout the novel. She had an intermittently strained relationship with her father. There was the death of her mother soon after birthing her. Not to mention, Shelley had given birth to her first child, a girl, which she lost several days later, the year before she began writing Frankenstein.
Monday the 6th. Find my baby dead. Wednesday the 8th. Sleep a little in the day. Thursday the 9th. Read and talk. Still think about my little baby. Sunday the 19th. Dreamt that my little baby came to life again, that it had only been cold, and that we rubbed it before the fire and it lived. I awake and find no baby. I think about the little thing all day. Not in good spirits.
Tragic and disappointing births continue to follow her. Shelley's creature, a self-proclaimed abortion, would outlast her. Creature's enduring legacy and appeal is due, in part, to his ability to wield language persuasively, to convince people of his humanity. Quote, I confess that my interest in the book is entirely on the side of the monster, one critic wrote in an 1824 review. His eloquence and persuasion, of which Frankenstein complains, are so because they are truth, that justice is indisputably on his side, and his sufferings are, to me, touching to the last degree. And it's through education that the creature attempts to emancipate himself from his lower position in society. Through education, the creature is able to, albeit temporarily, persuade others that he is a being worthy of life, friendship, and love, to persuade others to look beyond his physical disability and at the being within. With his eloquence, his erudition, and his command of language, the creature shifts the otherwise myopic fixation on his physical being, a fixation which, without his education, would continually label him with a singular classifier, deformed. Still, as we shall soon see, this classifier eventually trumps his education, his humanity. The creature's body is ultimately unignorable, and renders him unlistenable to those he encounters. The creature will encounter this problem with everyone he meets, save for an old blind man who cannot judge him by his appearance. I want to listen to the creature here, to let him speak. Hear my tale, he asks Victor. The creature later fills in the events after his birth, providing his account to Victor of his first feelings and memories.
It is with considerable difficulty that I remember the original era of my being. All the events of that period appear confused and indistinct. A strange multiplicity of sensations seized me, and I saw, felt, heard, and smelt at the same time. And it was, indeed, a long time before I learned to distinguish between the operations of my various senses.
The creature wanders alone from place to place, eventually encountering other humans who reject and fear him. Women faint, children scream, and men attack him. Fleeing hostile villagers and their sharp projectiles, the creature hides himself away in a hovel, a small shelter with a crude dirt floor, adjoined to a cottage. It is here where the creature begins his own education. Inside the hovel, the creature discovers a hole in the wall, through which he observes the cottagers, the De Lacy family, in their daily life and activities. From the other side of this wall, the creature learns different life lessons, language, and later, how to read, through studying and watching the De Lacys. His new education, the creature realizes, may allow the family to see him as a rational being like themselves, to see the man behind the monster.
Although I eagerly long to discover myself to the cottagers, I ought not to make the attempt until I had first become master of their language, which knowledge might enable me to make them overlook the deformity of my figure. For with this also the contrast perpetually presented to my eyes had made me acquainted.
Like Eric from The Phantom of the Opera, the creature is lonely and longs for companionship and for people to accept him. He desperately wants to reveal himself to the De Lacys, whom the creature has come to deeply love and admire from the other side of their shared wall. And again, like Eric, the creature realizes that these people may reject him because of the way his body looks. In perhaps the most tragic scene in the novel, the creature chooses to disclose himself to the De Lacys, approaching old man De Lacy, the blind man, when he is left alone in the cottage. The creature is anxious, scared of judgment, but desiring of a true and human connection, something he has never experienced. And he has another problem. If he directly asks the old man to meet his family, he must also admit to lurking in the shadows of their hovel. So instead, the creature invents a story. He tells the man that he has met some people in the village, some friends. He wants to reveal himself to them, but fears their rejection. He tells the old man,
"They are kind. They are the most excellent creatures in the world, but unfortunately, they are prejudiced against me. I have good dispositions. My life has been hitherto harmless and in some degree beneficial. But a fatal prejudice clouds their eyes, and where they ought to see a feeling and kind friend, they behold only a detestable monster."
Old man De Lacy responds kindly that, if he is good like he says he is, the friends will accept him, but still the creature hesitates. He fears that they won't, and spoiler, they don't. Percy Shelley, Mary Shelley's poet husband, offers one of the many morals of the story.
Treat a person ill, and he will become wicked. Let one being be selected, for whatever cause, as the refuse of his kind. Divide him, a social being, from society, and you impose upon him the irresistible obligations, malevolence, and selfishness.
In other words, you become a monster when excluded from society. Again, spoiler, the creature ends up murdering everyone Victor loves. But who can blame him? The creature is out to make Victor as lonely as Victor has made him. Still, we need other stories that aren't about lonely disabled people exacting vengeance on the people who have rejected their love. Before the creature turns murderous, he forms another identity, one that is good-natured, curious, and loving. He does so through literature. After learning how to read, the creature happens upon a satchel of books in the woods. The contents include a copy of Milton's Paradise Lost, a volume of Plutarch's Lives, and Goethe's Sorrows of Young Werther. He continues his education, now more or less entirely self-directed, and begins to apply his readings to himself and to his position in the world.
As I read, however, I applied much personally to my own feelings and condition. My person was hideous and my stature gigantic. What did this mean? Who was I? What was I? Whence did I come? What was my destination? These questions continually recurred, but I was unable to solve them.
These were questions that I also grappled with when I first became ill, reawakening into a body I no longer recognized, and that I too found hideous. What did this mean? Who was I? What was I? What was the destination? Like the creature, I felt alone. I had no one to guide me in my new, unexpected life. The creature, like other disabled people before and after him, was struggling to make sense of his identity as a disabled person in a society that hated him.
I felt like a monster in terms of my own perception of myself. Like, I knew that I wasn't living a quote-unquote normal life. Nobody, whether students or teachers, ever treated me differently. But my own self-perception was that I was a monster sitting in this class with other normal people. Again, nobody ever acted that way towards me, but my own perception of myself was certainly that I was kind of like this secret monster kind of masquerading as a regular student, sitting down at the desk and taking notes like everybody else, but promptly going home to take like a 30-minute shower and try to deal with my anxiety before even attempting to start my assignments or whatever. So yeah, it was more of a self-perception because I guess it comes from like looking around at the people who are around you and seeing that, you know, they don't wear nitrile gloves everywhere because they're afraid of touching doorknobs. No one ever treated me like I was a monster, but I did feel like one because I knew I wasn't living like other people.
This is my friend Anne. She's a master's student in English. I met Anne over a decade ago in undergrad. She's tall, had long blonde hair, and always wore a trench coat. Later, she wore these blue medical gloves everywhere. These blue gloves, it turns out, had a function: to avoid contamination because of her obsessive compulsive disorder, her OCD. But let's back up a bit. Anne developed an eating disorder as a teenager, but it didn't interfere much with her education at the time, finishing high school and continuing on to undergrad. But after moving away to a new city for university, away from her support systems, Anne developed a comorbid anxiety disorder, OCD, and this, she tells me, had a big impact on her university experience.
I, in addition to thinking about food and calories constantly, was also thinking about cleanliness constantly. And that's when the wheels really started to fall off in my experience as an undergrad, because I was so nervous about feeling contaminated that I eventually didn't really want to leave the house. And so what had already been a bit of a struggle, getting to classes, moving around campus, finishing my projects, because with an eating disorder, my energy was low, I now also had this added issue where it's like, I was just terrified of being out of doors because touching other people on the bus to school made me feel dirty, like sitting in these desks that hundreds of other students pass through daily made me feel dirty. Just anything and everything suddenly became a challenge at this point. And so I tried to shift to online classes, but interestingly, this was pre-COVID, and there were not very many choices in terms of online courses you could take. It was very limited, and the structure and sort of delivery of online classes was pretty rudimentary. So I was really losing a lot. You know, I'm really glad that there was still the option to go online, but it was a lot was lost basically in doing that.
What was lost, Anne tells me, was the experience of feeling like a university student. Online delivery was clunky, the web interface was not very intuitive. By design, distance education was all very perfunctory. Limited online options available also meant that Anne struggled to complete her degree credits.
The real issue was this lack of variety in the online courses available, because I was trying to finish my credits, but it's like they didn't offer very many things to choose from. It might be like English 235, but I'd already taken English 235, so what was I supposed to do if I needed a specific credit?
Anne was learning from behind another kind of wall, that is, distance education. The wall here, however, wasn't necessarily bad. It allowed her to learn from home where she could better manage her illnesses. But, as has already been said, distance education had its flaws, and in-person courses could not normally shift to being online if a student's health situation had changed. Anne tells me about this last point during one particular stay at a psych ward for eating disorder treatment.
The last time that I had a serious hospital admission was halfway through a semester in which I'd been taking two classes. I was taking an art history class and I was taking a medieval literature class. And this was an interesting experience because I go to the psych ward and I really want to continue taking both of these classes by distance education somehow. I didn't want to have to drop out of them. It was like the years were stretching on. I was still not finished my undergrad. And here I am on the psych ward again, and I don't want my education to be derailed once again. So I contact each professor and tell them that I'm in the hospital and I want to continue taking their class, but just is there some way that a student could be a note taker for me? Because I already know that there are student note takers. Kids are able to participate in classes while having a disability all the time. So I thought There must be an option for me, basically. And the two professors had completely opposite reactions. The medieval studies professor was really accommodating. She was like, I'll do whatever we can to make this work. We'll basically set up a Skype and on my laptop, and you can kind of watch class that way and take notes, and you can hand your things in to me doing work from the psych ward. Just email me your papers or whatever else. The other professor, the art history professor, was like, nope, hard no. There's no way that I, like, what he said was that a big part of the art history class was seeing the slides, which I understand. My brother was in that class, so I was like, well, I have someone there already who could, you know, live stream the class for me or take notes for me or tell me what slides to look at. But this guy was just like, hard no, that's not an option. So I had to drop that course. I tried to take the medieval studies course with a professor that was so kind and accommodating, but that ended up not working in the end because I was just under way too much strain, and I guess I kind of had to call a spade and admit that I wasn't doing well and I needed to just focus on getting better instead of trying to juggle even just one class while being on the psych ward, which was really disappointing to me.
Finished her degree after 9 years, taking a year off before applying to graduate school. But she found, as do many students who transition to grad school, that the expectations had changed. There were increased standards for graduate student performance, a higher workload, and new pressures to respond to. A bad experience with a professor left Anne fearing that she would fail one of her courses, which would put her funding at risk. Her health started to slide again, and then, well, COVID hit.
Okay, I really can't afford to make any mistakes in this context. Like, this is even more, the stakes are even higher here than they were in the undergraduate context, which is a scary thing to sort of live with, because if you know that your health is precarious, high stakes are incredibly frightening. Like, your life is already precarious, let alone your position in a academic program or your position in a high pressure job. Like, that's difficult enough as it is, but if you're already juggling the stresses of a chronic illness, well, you're on high alert at all times. And that itself, I think, has taken its toll on me, just in the sense that I notice a lot of fallout from chronic stress, I guess. Like, my stomach problems are worse. I've developed more problems sleeping well. I don't think that COVID helped in any way. Like, I went into my graduate degree in 2019. Late 2019. COVID hadn't started. I was already anticipating graduate school would be difficult, but I did not expect, like, no one expected this pandemic to happen, and just the extra stress that added was something that I was really blindsided by and have tried to cope with, but it's been kind of messy. Luckily, I would say that in terms of the graduate department's response to sort of supporting students during COVID, it's been, I feel that it's been good. Like, no one's put any pressure on me, and that's good, because that's one thing I don't think I could have handled, was even more pressure.
I nod along, listening to Anne. I knew about that health precarity. The work I had put in between degrees to better my health was largely undone by grad school. Between degrees, I had gotten a firm diagnosis, grieved what I thought my life would look like, then got to work, figuring out how to best manage my symptoms. With a renewed hold on my health, I had re-entered academia, but, like Anne, new pressures and chronic stress caused my health to backslide. I couldn't sleep. There was just so much to think and do for my research, and it never ended. My brain was consumed with what contribution I would eventually make to academia, and I found that I was powerless to shut this obsessive thinking off. Halfway through my second year, I mysteriously began to suffer from chronic hives, a period which would last 6 months. I would also sweat through my clothes, an embarrassing new symptom that required me to leave academic functions or responsibilities early to change. An insidious pressure of being in academia is the coercion or insistence of ignoring these bodily warning signs in the ostensible pursuit of producing knowledge. And after rereading Frankenstein, I realized that Victor's story looked a lot like mine, and that there was another overlooked illness narrative here that was in need of reanimation. Here is another tale of the chronically ill university student, Victor Frankenstein's. Plot reminder, Victor's story begins with him departing for university, leaving his family behind to pursue his education.
I was now alone. In the university, whither I was going, I must form my own friends and be my own protector.
Driven by the obsession of his studies, Victor locks himself away in his apartment. His health is ignored. So too are his friends and family.
I had worked hard for nearly 2 years for the sole purpose of infusing life into an inanimate body. For this, I had deprived myself of rest and health.
Victor begins to suffer from heart palpitations, anxiety, and depression. Once at the university, it's fair to say that Victor's health is never the same again, meaning Victor could very well be read as a chronically ill student. Also meaning, academia literally makes him sick.
My cheek had grown pale with study and my person had become emaciated with confinement. Every night I was oppressed by a slow fever, and I became nervous to a most painful degree. The fall of a leaf startled me.
The morning after Victor creates, then abandons, his creature, nervously stumbling around the streets of Ingolstadt, Victor happens upon his childhood friend, Henry Clerval, who soon becomes his nurse over the next several months. Victor becomes seriously ill from this point on, and is confined to his room in the university for quite some time. Although his health gradually improves, owing to Clerval's unwavering care work, Victor suffers a number of health relapses throughout the remainder of the novel. He never gets better. His pursuit of forbidden knowledge ruins him.
For this, I had deprived myself of rest and health.
Is academia worth it? That is academia worth ruining our health over? In the next episode, we'll meet another disabled character, driven by their own obsessions, Lauren Oya Olamina, from Octavia Butler's novels Parable of the Sower and Parable of the Talents. We'll see what Lauren can teach us about being a disabled educator as she spreads her new school of thought, Earthseed, next time on Diagnosis Grad School.